All right, for our last session today, we have Mary Anne Ehlert coming in remotely, who is not here in person. Mary Anne, you are ready to go.
Okay, great, thank you. All right, good afternoon, everyone. I am here in Chicago. I'm sorry I couldn't be there with you. I unfortunately had a personal issue that I had to deal with here. So I am missing you all, and I was here, I was at the last conference, and I really do miss this one. So. I look forward to meeting you another time, but I hope to meet some of you as you ask your questions today. So let's get started. I'm going to talk about things I've learned over the years as I've been doing this for 37 years as a professional working with families. But most importantly, I'm a family member like you. I grew up with a sister who had cerebral palsy, and she's the one who taught me everything I'm going to teach you today, I hope. When she was 6 years old, I was six, she was two, she was diagnosed with cerebral palsy, and my parents didn't really know what that meant. Either did I, of course, I was six. And so as my parents came to me, they told me about my sister. Now, my sister also was a twin, who had a twin, who was typical, and we had other siblings, so we're six of us in the family at that time, six children. But my parents picked me because I was the oldest girl. I was the second mom in the household. And so they told me about Marcia, and they said, you're going to be her caregiver when you get older. And I thought that was the coolest job on the planet. I was one of those kids who loved being the teacher, even though with my older brothers. And so I didn't know what it meant at the time, but I learned over the years. My sister was about, as an adult, about age eight developmentally. I, as a young person, went everywhere, took her everywhere with me, and became her big sister, but I was really a protector as well. I didn't know what that meant when I was young until I got older. And to everything that occurred in our lives, I'd take her with me. And sometimes she had good experiences, sometimes bad, just like the rest of us. And I allowed that to happen. My parents wanted to protect her, and I was the one who's kind of pushing her into doing things that maybe my parents didn't think she could do, and she was able to grow. And then at the age of, she was 34, she was still living at home with my parents. By that time, I was already doing what I'm doing and teaching families. But I kept learning from my sister. I kept learning that she wanted normal. I kept learning even when she had negative experiences, she accepted them as part of life. And she was actually proud of some of them, that she made a mistake because she got to learn from them. So I learned how important mistakes are in our lives because we get to learn from them just like she did. But when I went to my sister and I asked her what she wanted for her life, she could communicate. She was verbal. And she told me that everybody moved out but her. And so she wanted to move out too. But what would mom and dad do without her? So she had this understanding that in the world that she lived in, she was pretty important to our family. My parents did allow her and helped her to go live residentially in a program that she was able to do things she never did before. She had started to develop an independence in a way as much as she could. She did have a one-on-one to help her, but we were there all the time. I was there all the time. My parents were very involved as I was, but she still had great experiences. And I tell that story because as parents, I'm now parents of some young men with disabilities, and we want to protect. Sometimes siblings, we want to go a little further, but as you become a parent and you realize you want to protect your child, it's a tough thing to do. So my parents always said that they wanted to live one day longer. They did. My sister passed away. Unfortunately, she had a seizure at the age of 40. She suffocated. She couldn't turn over in her sleep, and she suffocated that day from a seizure. It took me a while to get up in front of people and talk about this, but I keep learning. I keep learning from families. I keep learning from memories of have of her life. And then I have three young boys, almost some disabilities or stepsons, two with significant disabilities. So then I began to learn as mom how to be a protector. As my parents got older, they needed care. So my dad went blind and he had a lot of physical disabilities. My mother had dementia for 10 years of her life, last 10 years. So I was their caregivers too. So now I became a daughter as a caregiver. So it's a really interesting dynamic of the differences because sometimes I was doing many of those caregiving jobs all at one time. And it's hard. And it's hard to want to make sure that this person that we care for is safe and happy. But I also believe that parents, you're really important. If you're the caregiver in the audience, that you're also really important. So we're going to talk about some of those things. Our mission here at Protected Tomorrows is to make sure that our children, our family members with special needs are safe and happy. That's the bottom line for us. And so as we think about that, what does it mean to you? Because it's different for everybody, right? It's different for every parent. We also know that our lives are pretty complex. Everybody's life is complex. We all have so much to do making sure that our children are okay, that we're okay, that we're planning for retirement. And then you put on top of it all the other things that we have to do. And I'm going to talk about some of those things and how do we think about it? Because I know when I think about my boys, I want to live one day longer. I want to make sure they're always okay. I'm there for them. I'm their driver. I'm the one who keeps them when they're falling apart, the one who steps back in and takes make sure they're okay. And I know all of you are, if I was there, you'd be shaking your heads. So how do we think about this planning for the future and this transitioning into another stage of our child's life? Because there's many transitions. There's a transition from through early intervention. There's the transition into school. There's the transition out of school into transition programs, official transition programs. There's out of that into living away from our parents and the transition of living with our parents. So all these stages, and it's really scary for us. So somebody like me comes along and says, "Why you got to do a lot of things?" Over 37 years, I have learned that we can't do it all at one time. It's overwhelming. And sometimes when I try to help parents do too much at one time, they don't do it. And if I help them identify for this moment what's important, you can do it. So we're going to talk about some of these steps that we have created over time. And the first one is the really most important one. It's where you think about what do you want for your child. So when we think about that, some of this you'll find, some of these thoughts we're going to talk about is on our website. It's protectedtomorrows.com. It's brand new. We just kicked it off. We've got lots of new things in it. If any of you have looked at it before. And then we get done at the end, you'll see a little contact button on the top right corner. So if you get done and you want to reach out to us for any reason with questions, that's where you'll be able to do it. Because I'm not there. Usually I pass out cards that you can fill your questions in and give them to me at the meeting. Since I'm not there, you can go right to our website, click that contact button. There's a contact us button, and you can go in and type the questions you have if we don't have time at the end to answer all of them. Okay. And there is a chat box. So I'm going to count on the AV tech who's helping us to make sure that it's available to us at the end, hopefully. Okay. All right. So what's my goal today? My goal, because we only have an hour, is to create awareness. I'm going to hope to help you think about where you are today and where you need to go. What are the kind of things that you should be thinking about? So you actually have some action items out of today's class. So as I said, number one step is a really important step. So if you have a piece of paper with you, what I'd like you to do is take that piece of paper out and get a pen. And the first step I want to talk about is taking a candid look. What does that mean? How are we going to be honest with ourselves about what the future looks like? It is so easy to not think about some of the things that are scary. So I have two questions for you. Question number one is, what is the best thing that could happen for your child's future? What do you want? And we're going to take the cure off the table, because that's not something that I can help you with. There's lots of medical professionals doing that. But I can help you think about the future and how do we keep your child safe and happy. So number one question is, what is the best thing that can happen? And the second question I have for you is, what's your biggest fear? Because we have a lot to do with this. And so we're going to be doing the one, parents, you're important. So A, what's the best thing that can happen? What's your biggest fear? Just take a minute and write those things down. Why do I want you to do this? Because somebody taught me once, if you want something to happen, you have to know what success looks like, and you have to know what failure looks like too. Because how do you get somewhere without recognizing when you're on the wrong path and the right path. So I call these our benchmarks. So I'll tell you, if I was face-to-face, I would ask you questions about what's the best thing that can happen and what's your biggest fear. So let's talk about what I hear most of the time. Let's play, we're being family feud today. And I ask you what's the best thing would happen. I wish I could, you know, reach out to you and have you yelling your answers out to me. But I'll tell you what I typically hear. I hear, I want my child happy. I want to make sure they have a safe place to live. I want to make sure they have funds. I want to make sure they're financially secure. I want to make sure they're okay. I want to make sure if they have the capacity to do something productive, they get that opportunity. I want, but mostly it's about happy and safe, right? That's what we want first. So that's it. Number one answers are happy and safe. Number one and two answers. And what do I hear about the fears? Most people say, well, they run out of money or they don't have friends or they're sad. So all those things that we said were positive. They're seeing them, the opposite of them happening. The number one answer is abuse, that we are not around forever and that something happens to our child and it's negative. It's a negative experience that is really hurtful for them, right? So if I said, what are my benchmarks for my son? I have a son who's mentally ill. He has OCD. He's blind. He is not able to function 100% in the world. He's getting a little better, but he has days where he falls apart and could harm himself. So it's scary. It is scary, right? So I say, what do I want him to have? Happy. I want him to be able to have friends. It's really hard for him to have friends. I want him to, he's tried work, but it's just difficult for him. He's tried some interesting things, but he struggled. And then when he succeeds, all of a sudden he fails. So my fear is that he will hurt himself again, and it would be a really bad time for him. So he's made significant progress, and I hope it happens. So what's the best thing and what's our fears? We have to know what those are. So I see my son living in a, he's living in a residential program. He's doing really well. Some of the good things are happening, and if he had friends around him and he could come up with a job that he could do at a whatever level he can do it at, that would be great, right? So I want you to do that for yourself, because keeping those things every time you make a decision in this planning process of the future for your child, kind of have to know what you want, and you kind of have to know what you don't want. Because if you always, when you make a decision, look to those things, those are what's going to drive good decisions, right? And avoid bad ones. So if we kind of know what that looks like, let's talk about steps. And I know you've had some other programs today that talk about some other things. So I'm going to try not to replicate what they did, but I'm going to talk at a high level and talk about some of the really important things for you to do. So when we talk about, once we kind of know the high level, because sometimes I'm going to tell you the step. These steps aren't easy. But I also tell you, families that I've worked with for many, many years say it was the key to what they're, how they got there. Well, they come to me after 30 years of doing work with them and they say, our family wouldn't be where it is today without these steps that you make us go through and make you go through. It sometimes is the case, right? We need, I always say, find somebody else. If you're not working with someone like us doing it, you've got to find someone who's going to hold you accountable. We all need that. You know, I'm always in a health program trying to gain weight, lose weight, eat right, have, you know, just be healthy, right? And so I go through that up and down stuff, and I need somebody to say, you're not doing what you said you're going to do. Don't do that or go to your workout. I need that. And so you need that for this step. We all need someone to push us along. Maybe it's your spouse. Maybe it's your other children. Maybe it's a friend. It's more a friend sometimes than it is family. Friends have a hard time pushing us. So I'm going to ask you a question. This is not a financial planning class, but have you done your financial planning, right? When we get on an airplane, and with our child, a child, we're told to put the oxygen mask on ourselves first. It's not instinctive. As parents, we want to take care of our children, but we have to take care of ourselves. And sometimes parents say to me, everything I have is going to go to take care of my child in the future. And they might have three children, but they're thinking about financially, thinking the other two will be okay and this one needs help. But we don't, I didn't hear families say, well, we're going to be okay. I hear families say, whatever we have left is going to go to our child. Well, what if you didn't do your own planning and 100% of what you have is nothing and you're leaving nothing, right? You, mom and dad, or mom or dad, I'm a single mom, are the most important person in your child's life. We can agree on that. You are the most important person in your life too. And if you don't take care of you, your child's not going to be okay. You've got to take care of you. And I will tell you, I've been on days where I've been taking care of so many people at one time that I forget myself. And sometimes I just have to go away somewhere and just feel sad and feel bad for myself and get back up and go back into it, right? So this step cannot be one that you avoid. I watch too many people do that. You are important. So what do you have to do? And what do you have to be ready for if you're going to do some planning around the future? You're going to be thinking about what your child needs. You cannot fund those things and you cannot plan those things unless you plan for yourself first. Even when you're going to an attorney and doing your legal work, they're going to ask you for these things. So the first thing I'm going to tell you you need is a net worth statement. And some of these forms, we will be able to coordinate to get these to you. We'll give you an email at the address at the end where you can request them. Okay. So this first form is called a net worth statement. It's what you got. It's what you owe. Right. Simple. On the left side is all the things. I own my home. I have some bank accounts. I have a 401k at my job. I have other things. Right. On the right side is, oops, I don't really own them. I have a mortgage. I have a car payment. I have credit cards. That's what you owe. And so if you take what you own and subtract what you owe, you figure out what you're worth. Any person who's going to work with you and help you make sure your child's okay is going to ask you about yourself. It goes against our grain as parents, especially as a parent who has a child who needs more than the ordinary care. So we're going to put you first for a little while. And I think it's funny, when people come in, sometimes their shoulders are up. And I say to a parent, you know what? Let's take care of you first. And their shoulders go down. We're not used to having people coming to us and taking care of us. We're caregivers. So besides what you owe and what you own, the other things you own are life insurance policies, maybe long-term care insurance policies, house insurance, all that stuff, gather it. Put it on a sheet paper. Why? It's really important to an attorney you're working with, because if you have money or don't have money, how will they help you is important. The other thing you need to do for yourself is create a cash flow. Some of us call it a budget. Budget kind of feels restrictive. So I'm going to call it cash flow. And it's going to say on the left-hand row, how much do I make? What's coming in from my job? What's coming in if I'm retired from Social Security or a pension? What's coming in from Medicaid dollars? Perhaps you're a personal support worker for your child and you're getting some Medicaid waiver money. That goes in the top. On the bottom is all your expenses. What do you spend on your house and your car and your, you know, you're saying, what does this have to do with my child? It has everything to do with your child. As a matter of fact, we're going to do one of these just for your child in a little bit. And if you go to the right side, I know it's hard to read because this is probably on a big screen and you're not next to it. But you go about five rows down on the second piece of paper up there, and it says PWD Future Care, right? And that PWD is Person with a Disability's Future Care. What is that? Well, your child's, you're paying something for them now outside of your normal. I want you to separate it. You got to separate you and your child. So what do you spend on them? We're going to do a separate budget for them, and we're going to bring it back into yours. But you know what? I call this retiring for free. Or how many children you have. So I'm single, but I have three boys who have needs. So I'm retiring for four, right? I don't get to retire and just say, well, I'm done. I have to think about the whole thing. And so on this cash flow for you, you're going to do your own. We're going to plug in some numbers for your child and bring it back into this plan. Because when you retire, you don't get to stop funding that as well. So it's really important. But guess what? You deserve vacations. You deserve a retirement. And we want to make sure that your child is safe, but you also are safe and happy yourself, right? So this is an important step. The other things you should be gathering in your planning process is your Social Security statements. You need to know What are you going to get at 62, 65, 67, 70? What would you get? You also need to look on the left-hand bottom corner, and it shows you a couple other numbers. And one of the important numbers is you'll see something that says total family benefits cannot be more than $6,000 a month. That is the family max. So one of you each will have a number, but one of you will have probably a higher number. There's another number here that says a minor child. Now, the minor child number is a child under 18 or a disabled adult child. And that is the max your child will be able to get. And you're going, wait a minute, I think I saw a class earlier today that the SSI my child will get is 963. This is another number, okay? The amount your child can get from your Social Security once you take it will be, while you're alive and retired, they will be eligible for one half of your own age 67 benefit. And when you pass away, they'll be eligible for 75% of your age 67 benefit. Now you're saying, well, there's mom and dad. They're going to use, for simple sake here, they're going to use the higher one in most cases. All right. So you could look at your own record and say, what would I get at 67 over here? And we're going to say, okay, half of that is what your child's eligible for while you're alive and taking it. And the other one, they're eligible for 75% of it when you pass away. Why is that important? Because we're going to use those numbers when we plan for your child. We have to know if they're going to need a certain amount to live on. Now you're saying, well, aren't I going to get Medicaid money and group home money? Maybe, probably, but that's not going to fund your childhood. Now, other things I want you to know about yourself is, do you have a pension? So teachers' pensions, federal pensions, many state pensions, fire and police pensions. If you look at them, you need to research your pension, because a pension, usually you say, okay, if I pass away, my wife gets it, my husband gets it, right? But there are pensions that say when you both pass away, your child, if they have a disability, gets it, gets half of it probably, right? So research your pension and find out, because that could do great things for your child or could totally hurt them. If that pension pays to your child directly, they could lose their benefits. Really important, okay? So we want to research the pension, because if there is a pension that our child could get, we want to make sure that pension allows it to be paid to a special needs trust. Lots of rules. The other thing you need to know is that your child is on your health insurance plan mostly. When your child's young, you probably have them as a child. What age is it when your child can no longer stay on your health insurance? Most people in an audience would say, oh, age 26. I know that my company told me that. Well, most companies and most states require that if your child has a disability, the health insurance plan is, your child's allowed to stay on that group health insurance plan if they have a disability, as long as you have that job. A lot of people don't know that. I was just working with an HR person who runs a pretty big company. And I said, does your plan cover children with disabilities after the age of 26? She said, no, they're 26. And I said, well, okay, go back to the health company that's providing program, Blue Cross. And they asked, and indeed it did. But when the child turns over 26, you have to fill out a form. A lot of families don't know that. Many of you, you know, when I was doing this 20 years ago, it wasn't like that. When I was doing it 10 years ago, it was, but families didn't know. So my job today is to give you enough data so that you're thinking about the future. And when we talk about transitions for your child and we talk about how do you build plans for your child, this is all part of it, right? If something happens to you, and your child's on your health insurance plan for some period of time, the question is, how long can they stay on it till you have it? And when you don't have it anymore, their child's health insurance goes away. Oops, we got to think about that. Your financial planning gets really complex when we start thinking about the need to provide money and insurance for your child into the future. I'm going to keep giving you things to look up. A. When should you take your Social Security? Most people would say, I'm going to go onto the computer and I'm going to do one of those Social Security analyzers, and my husband and I are going to put our numbers in, and it's going to tell us who to take it first and who to take it second. That's one way. Another way is, oh, we don't have enough money, we better take it sooner. But the third way you need to consider it is, you remember what I said about that DAC money that your child will get when you retire, when you start taking your Social Security and your child goes into another program? When you retire, I'm going to give you a real simple example. I was married and my husband and I were both, maybe he's 67 and I was 65. And he's going to retire at 67. And so I said, well, I'll wait till 67 too. I'll get the bigger amount of my Social Security. We started thinking about it. If he's going to retire at 67 and my child, our child, is on his health insurance, and he waits to quit to before we worry about my child's health insurance. We wait a little. My husband quits at 67. My child's without health insurance. The day he quits, my child's without health insurance. What am I going to do? So I think, well, maybe I, as a spouse, shouldn't wait till I'm 67 to take my Social. Maybe I should take it. Maybe I should take it sooner than that, because when I'm 65, be 67. Maybe I should take it at 65 early. Why would I do that? Because if I take it at 65, that's probably not soon enough, right? Maybe I should take it earlier, because if I take it at 65, my husband's already 67. He's great. I need to take it 2 years before my husband retires. Because when he retires, the health insurance is gone. So why do I say 2 years? Because when one of us starts our Social Security, our child gets Social Security on our record, that DAC. But with that comes a really important program called Medicare. So I'm going to show you how benefits work. What you want to be thinking about when you take your Social Security. So in this situation where I said we were 67 and 65, if my husband, we have to get our child on a program 2 years before dad loses his health insurance. That means dad is 65, which would mean I'm 63. I need to apply for my Social Security at 63. Because I'm in it, my child can apply under my program. My child could get Social Security under my program called DAC, and they would have a two-year wait to get Medicare. By the time my husband retires, my child's on Medicare. Complicated thing. You're not like everybody else. Don't use those computer systems to tell you when to do it, because you're going to have a surprise. Know how your Social Security, when you take Social Security, changes when your child gets benefits. I'm going to show you a little diagram on that. Okay. So also understand your child's health insurance. So now your retirement is impacted by what your child's transition into the future looks like. The other things that happen is, when can you become your child's personal support worker? Okay, so if you're going to get Medicaid dollars, your child gets into a waiting list and they get Medicaid home-based dollars or some kind of other funding from Medicaid. But you can become your child's personal support worker, right? Or you could use those funds to get a personal support worker for your child. Many families say, okay, I'm going to stay home, husband's going to work, I'm going to become the personal support worker. And there's a lot of rules around that. That could be a whole class. But just recognize all those things, that when you become the personal support worker, you're getting a salary from the government. It's tax-free for personal support worker money from the government, called home-based money. There's a tax code that says, if you're the caregiver and your child's living at home and you're taking care of them and you get this money, could be about $2,000 a month. If it's three times the SSI amount. So if you're getting about a couple thousand a month take home, it's tax-free. That sounds really great, doesn't it? But it's income. And so it counts towards Social Security giving you some credits, but they don't take Social Security off it. There's a lot of rules around this. But it also counts as income when you take your Social Security. So you've got to be careful and get some advice as to, if you're going to take your Social Security early and you're also the child's PSW, there's all kinds of changes you have to make about who's the employer, who's the employee. I'm giving you a lot of details. Just keep it in the back of your head that taking your Social Security impacts your child, and becoming your child's personal support worker impacts your taxes and impacts your when you can take your Social Security. They all blend together. If you have questions about that and you're getting older, email us and we'll send you some tools. Okay, so all those things impact your planning for retirement. And all those things impact your child, right? So let's talk about your child for a minute. You're going to transition into different stages of life. How much money do you need to leave for your child? For years and years, I started doing this in 1989. And I would tell people, all I know is it's a big stack. I use the same screen. I said it was a big stack of money. If you ask me now, I can calculate. We've gotten pretty sophisticated over the years. We've calculated lots and lots of family situations. And if you help us do those cash flows, we can actually calculate how big that stack has to take care of your child. How do you do it? Just like we do it for you. If I was doing your financial plan, I would say, how much do you need to live? I would do that for your child. How much do they need to live? Taking into account that they're getting a SSI, taking into account that maybe Medicaid is paying for where they're living or maybe it's not, taking in the fact that they're living with you or they're not, all those things come into what's coming in and what is the cost of them to live. Now, I've had parents say, my child's living in a group home, they're getting funding, but they're getting some kind of service and it doesn't cost me anything else. Yes, it does. Think about it. You take them on vacation with you? Yeah. You take them out to dinner with you? Do they get a haircut? The government doesn't pay for any of that, right? So we just had an interesting, somebody said to me, well, we don't ever go on vacation with our child because there's no places to go. If you ever listen to our classes, we have a parent university class. And if you're interested, go on our website and they're posted. We had a class 2 months ago about how do you take vacation with your child and what kind of programs are out there where you could take your child and they will assign, there's a whole cruise line of autism that takes, or for a child with intellectual disabilities, and they will assign a program to your child, or they will assign a caregiver to your child while you're on that ship. Or there is a camp, Morgan's Wonderland in, I think it was Texas, that actually just is for persons with disabilities and their families. So many different programs out there. So, for vacations and for help and for assistance. So when we're doing this, we have to think about that. If you want while your child's living with you supports, what are the costs related to it? What's their recreation cost? What's their education cost? What's their caregiving cost that are not funded by the government? So we have to do that. And then we look at it and we say, we create the vision for your child. We're going to figure out what their living expenses are over and above what the government's going to pay. All those expenses coming out of, they're not going to school anymore. They're coming out of transition and you're starting to think about what are their medical bills over and above the insurance pays? What are the caregiving costs? What are the recreation costs? What is fun for them? What's the education cost? Going to these conferences. I know the conference maybe not very much, but you still got to pay for rooms and you still got to pay for things. That's part of your vacation. The water park is fantastic. That's what I really wanted. It would have been fun. I know the last year was fun. And so I watch you, your children enjoying those pools, right? Does it cost something? So yes, if you want that to continue, if something happens to me and my children who have some disabilities, I want their lives to continue. I got to think about all of this, right? I've got to think about all those. So what's really important, I will tell you that if you have a child with a disability and you want them to be safe and happy, you also have to think about getting benefits. I have people who tell me often, well, we don't want to take money from the government. We'll leave it for the people who probably really need it. Well, if you don't get into the system, you can't get some of the opportunities that exist. There's lots of programs that are funded by Medicaid. And so you have to be able to get that ticket in order to get in, even if you don't get the dollars to get into the program, you need it. Again, your benefits become really important. I'm going to walk through really quickly because I think you've had other program about this. I'm going to talk about it really quickly. 2024, what are the numbers? SSI is $943 a month. The income limit is $1,550 a month, the most a person can make and still get their SSI. The Medicaid asset limit is $17,005. You say, what happened to that $2,000 number? The SSI asset limit is $2,000. The Medicaid asset limit is $17,005. So I'm going to do a quick walkthrough of how this works, all right? If I become disabled, I could get SSDI. And that comes with Medicare. That's for me, okay? I've worked, I paid into it. They take money out of my, they call it FICA, out of our checks, and that's paying for that. But my sister or my son never worked. So when they become 18, they become eligible for SSI, which is at $943 a month. You have to position your child to A, prove that we can't, they can't work, which is usually pretty easy. We have medical records. But the harder part, if we don't pay attention to it, is they cannot have more than a house. They can own a home. You're not going to have them do that. They're not going to drive, probably, maybe. But they can have a house. They can have a car. They can have a prepaid funeral. They can have $2,000. And they have an ABLE account. Okay. The $2,000 includes everything but the ABLE. It includes savings accounts. It includes any investment accounts you have in their name. You don't want to put money in your child's name if they're young. And once they're 18, they definitely can't have this money. You can't make it disappear. So we want to position them to get SSI by proving they have a disability, proving they have no assets. And with SSI comes Medicaid. Now, even though Medicaid allows you to have $17,500 in your child's name, SSI still has a limitation. So you still you keep the $2,000 limitation. That's how it starts. Your child gets it at 18. Okay? No income limits on the upper categories, but income and asset limits on the bottom categories. So let's go through one simple example. And I'm not going to take a ton of time because we could spend probably a half hour on this, but I'm going to go through it quickly because we have a lot of things that this impacts. So in this particular instance, I just picked a few numbers and said, if you were the dad at age 67, your benefit says you will get $2,400 a month of Social Security. For this person too, it also says, what would the child get? On dad's record, the child could get up to $1,800 a month, which is 2/3 of his $2,400. Not 2/3, 75%. And the family benefit would be the max they could pay on dad's record is $4,100 a month. So how is this going to work for this family's child and the mom and dad? So dad retires, okay? Dad's going to retire, but we're going to start with saying, okay, we know that these are the benefits and the SSI amount is 943. So your child turns 18 years old. It's a month after they turn 18, we can apply for SSI for that. Yep, jump through all the hoops, make sure we prove they're disabled, make sure they have no money. They'll get 943 a month. And when they get that 943 a month, we've already proven they don't have any assets. They might have a small account with some money in it. And we make sure that they qualify for Medicaid because Medicaid is the big dollar. SSI is $943 a month. Medicaid is the big dollar. Medicaid pays for healthcare programs. It pays for all the programs out there. It pays for residential support. It pays the personal support worker and it pays for job coaches. It pays all the big dollars, right? And as long as our child's still on SSI, we still have to limit them to the $2,000, no matter what Medicaid says. Okay? So that's where we start. Now, mom, this is that whole thing of when do we start Social Security for mom and dad? When dad retires, his record said he's going to retire at 67. He says he could get $2,600 a month. Okay, so dad's getting $2,600. Mom worked and made very little. She had hardly any Social Security records. So we're going to assume that at the time dad retires, they look at mom's and she's, wow, she hardly has anything. So we're going to give her one half of dad's. But she has no real record herself. She stayed home mom. So dad gets $2,600. The way Social Security works is you get your own or a half of your spouse's, whichever is greater. So in her case, half of her spouse's was more. So dad's going to get $2,600. Mom is going to get $1,300. There's $500 left in that record. So when they do mom and dad's record, they're going to say, ah, mom and dad got theirs, but there's $500 left from dad's record on the max. So we're going to give the child $500 a month. DAC is up in that left-hand corner. See it? Okay, up here. So here we are. Child went from here to here. Well, they were getting $943. Now they're giving them $500 from this bucket. And they lowered the SSI to $443. They're still getting $943, but they lowered it because they were eligible for that. They go, well, two checks, so what? It's still the same amount. Well, it is, but when they become eligible for DAC 2 years later, this is really important because when the dad's health insurance goes away, we want your child eligible for Medicaid. Medicare will be their basic, Medicaid will be their secondary. Okay. All right. So they're still getting this amount. Dad dies. What happens? Well, if dad dies, mom's going to get dad's. Mom's going to get $2,600. Okay. So child was getting this, they were getting this, and they were getting this. When dad died, mom's going to get more. And when both parents pass away, the highest the child will get is that max. So now the child's getting this. They don't get the 943 anymore because 1,800 is more than that. They're getting this. They keep this. And they keep this as long as their assets are below the 17.5. We don't care about the 2,000 anymore. There's no asset limit up here. So I'm trying to teach you that when you take your Social Security, it changes the way your child gets benefits. Pay attention to the group insurance laws. Go to your HR department. I will tell you, I just talked to a big company's HR person and she didn't know this. She went back to the insurance company and she learned something. And I said, you know what? She says, wow, all the people in my company who have a disabled child, they're eligible for that. I said, yes, they are. Okay. We as parents are the advocates. We are important. So we need to understand that. We need to understand the health insurance laws. We have to know how the Social Security system works. And we have to know that it's always changing. Okay. Complicated stuff. So I started off by saying, we're going to do a plan for you. Secondarily, we're going to do benefits for your child. And third, we said, we're going to have to leave a lot of money for your child. And I just go through telling your child can't have money. How's that work? Okay. So let's look at some other things you need to do without getting into too much detail, legal stuff. I just want you to know, remember a couple of things. A, you cannot leave money directly to your child. You can't leave the money in your will. You shouldn't give it to the other kids and say, please take care of your brother. Okay? There's a risk to that. Putting anybody's money in somebody else's hands is a risk. And so we have to do something called a special needs trust. I don't know if you had an attorney speak at the conference, but this is a really important step for you. Make sure that you do a trust called a special needs trust. So you'll have your wills, and your wills will say, if we pass away, leave our child's money to a special needs trust. How it works is the inheritance goes into the trust when you pass away. Most of the time they're empty till you die. Not always, but a lot of times they're empty. The money is spent for the supplemental care of your child. When you pass away, the child gets this pot of money, but it's not theirs. That's why it works. It's spent for their supplemental care. We're naming trustees who are going to manage it. That money is for their support. This is really important to the future transition of your child into other things, right? Because we need this money. And then the document says, who's in charge? You. But you're going to name who's in charge after you. These are important things we're going to talk about when you build your dream team. And when your child passes away, you're going to say who gets it. Government's not going to take any of it. You set it aside. If there's anything left when your child passes away, you're going to say the other heirs get it. Maybe the Angelman Syndrome Foundation gets it. Who knows, right? You will make all the decisions. You're in control. So what do you need to know? What are the rules of a special needs trust? One, who sets it up? You. Your child can't set it up. They can't own it. They can't control it. Who's in charge? You. And when you pass away or when you get sick, your document is going to say, who's going to do it? I call these the money people. Who's going to take care of your child's money? I'll tell you one thing. When I'm working with families, and I've been working with them for 30 years, and they started with me when they're 50, another 70, or there some of them are 80, some are 85. And they're saying, when we did this, we were in charge, mom and dad. And we put our other kids in charge of the money. Or we made our other kids future guardians. And now they're saying to me, why? What were we thinking? We changed the lives of our other children. We didn't mean to do that. We just had no one else to do it. So I'm giving you hindsight that I have after working with families who are now saying, what is our other options? If we don't want to give the other kids or our siblings those jobs, who are we going to put in there? Some of them are finding trust companies who can do it. Some of them are looking for corporate guardians who can do it. Everybody's answer is different, but you do have to name other people. So when should you do this? This is important. People say sometimes, why don't you do it yet? I'm pretty young. I don't think there's any rule here about how long we get to live. So you should need to set it up while you're alive and competent. Only two rules, live and competent. Don't put it inside your will. People say, oh, I got a special needs trust. Here's my will right here. It says it's my will. In my will, it says that I'm creating a special needs trust when I die. That's called a testamentary will that does what you say when you die. The problem with that is, if you go to the attorney and they say to do that, I would say, maybe you're not in the right office. Maybe you're in somebody else's office. Because an attorney who knows how to do this will do it differently. Why do I say that? If my will says when I die, create a special needs trust, it gets created at my death. I don't know when I'm going to die. And I also don't know what the rules are in regard to special needs trusts when I die. People don't think of themselves as dying in a year, right? So if that's the case, and I don't know when I'm going to die, and I want to make sure this is special needs trust, I need to create it now, okay? I want it to be a document. I want to walk out with a book that says special needs trust on the front. I have a will, and he has a will, we're a couple, and our wills say, I'm leaving it to you, honey. And then he says, but if we pass away, we're leaving it to the children, but the children with special needs is getting in a special needs trust. And I have a separate book that's called a special needs trust. Why do we do that? A, we want to make sure that it's following the rules of today because now it's a really great law. I don't know what the future holds. We hope it continues to exist, but if I get a trust and it's signed now under the laws of today, it's always going to exist. I might want to update it in the future, but it exists today. If I don't do it now, it will not get created until I die. When I die, I don't know what the rules will be. Okay? So I want to do that. I also don't want my mom and dad to have to go create a trust if they want to leave something. I want to have the trust all set up. So if grandparents or siblings want to leave something to your child, they can leave it to the trust you set up. Okay, so make sure it's a separate document. And how do you get money in there? Your will puts it in there. These are things to remember. You got to look at all your life insurance, make sure the beneficiaries are right. So why do I bring that life insurance thing? This is what happens. Life insurance has beneficiaries on it. I find that most people don't even know what they put as their beneficiaries if they have policies for a long time. Go back and pull your life insurance out and say, what did I put? And if you check the box on your life insurance at work that says they asked you on the second day on your job, who's the beneficiary? You say my spouse. If you go back to that form, I'm going to bet you said my spouse and then my children, if my spouse isn't alive. That's not right. Because if you're leaving it to children, the word children, you're leaving it to your children, including your child with special needs, and they will get disqualified from all the work that you did for benefits. So make sure that the beneficiaries don't say children, but say, I'm leaving my assets to my spouse. And if my spouse isn't alive, I'm leaving it to Tim, I'm leaving it to Mark, and I'm leaving it to Matt's special needs trust. Okay. The child that has a special need, their share has to go to the trust that you created. Now, if you don't have a trust yet, you can't do that. So you have to get the trust. And then you go back to your retirement accounts and your life insurance, and you check the beneficiaries on everything to make sure nothing gets to your child by mistake. People say, well, I'd never do that. I see it all the time, right? You forgot you had this life insurance policy that mom and dad bought you when you were two, right? All kinds of things. All right. There is one other kind of trust. Some of you might be sitting there going, oh, we forgot about something, or we forgot to tell grandma, and grandma has in her will, and she leaves your child $50,000. But you didn't know there was a special needs trust. So your child gets this money and now they're going to lose all their benefits. There's another kind of trust called a payback trust. I call it, oops, somebody made a mistake. Or your child wins a lotto, whatever. They get too much money. There's a special kind of trust. The difference is it works the same way as the other one. But when the child passes away, Medicaid in your state or any states that your child got benefits from has the right to claw back money out of that trust before it goes to the other heirs. So this is only a mistake. Only have to reference that when you know, oh, I already have $100,000 sitting in my child's name and I have to get it out. You can't just take it out. You have to do this. So how do you start with this part of it? Okay. Your part, you got to get your assets. You got to build your net worth statement. You got to build the cash flow. You build the cash flow of your child and you get your child their benefits. You got to find an attorney, but you have to find an attorney who knows what they're doing. You can go to our website. You can also go look up the Special Needs Alliance. You can look up NALA, which is the National Academy of Elder Law Attorneys. Lots of places that you could find attorneys in your area. If you can't find one, I'll give you my email address before we finish. You email us, we'll help you identify some attorneys in your area. You've got to work with an attorney who does this, not an attorney who says, I do. Attorneys have expertise, right? The other area that we do will see a lot of work in is divorce. So if somebody's getting divorced, in most states, the person who's the custodian parent might get child support from the person who's the other person, husband or wife, whoever's the stay-at-home person, might be getting some child support. Child support can be ordered for the lifetime of the child, not till they're 18 or 21, but for the lifetime of the child. But it has to go into, let's look at these trusts, the one on the right, which is the payback trust. That's where child support goes. Because child support, when paid to the mom or dad, whoever's getting it, it's their money until the child's 18. Once a child's an adult, age 18, the child support is considered theirs and it will disqualify them from the benefits. So when we're getting divorced, all I will tell you is the attorneys are really important. And no matter what kind of attorney you use for your wills and your trusts or for divorce, they need to have special needs expertise. Our worlds are different. Maybe 5% of the attorneys in this country who do legal estate planning have a lot of special needs experience. Be careful, make sure you're finding the right people to help you. Okay, that was a hard, that was easy stuff, right? All right? Now let's talk about the hard stuff. Because you can find a financial person to help you. You could find an attorney to help you. You could find a government person to help you. But now you're going to be asking somebody to take, step into your shoes and do a really hard job, or the hardest job. It's maybe they don't think about it that way. If I ask someone who would step in for my son, I have people who say, well, I could do that. Because they know he's kind of residentially set. But people who are, I mean, even in my own family, when my sister was still alive, my other sister thought, because she's a medical professional, she thought for sure she was the one who was in the documents my parent left behind to be the one responsible for my sister. But that wasn't the case. My parents had named me only because I did this, right? Even though maybe, and from a medical perspective, I could never be a doctor. My sister is a midwife. So she had a lot of medical experience. You'd think she'd be the better caregiver. But I was the one connected to my sister, so they'd need me. The interesting thing is, the people who don't get the job are worried about it. My sister said to me later after my sister passed away, she said, wow, I always worried about if mom and dad passed away, I was going to get that job. I don't think I could do it. She said, if I had known you were going to get it, I wouldn't have worried, right? So this is a big job. That's why I say when people get older and they say, oh, I didn't realize that the big job I was leaving the other kids, I just gave it to them. The attorney said, who I gave them names? Think about it. Okay? It's hard. Who's going to do those government benefits? Who's going to make sure your child has a fun life? That they participate in reparation programs and get to the right day program, whatever it is. Okay. The other thing you need to think about is what happens when your child turns 18. You're still their mom and dad. You're not their legal guardian. You're not. So you either have to go to court. You can do nothing. If you do nothing, you have no rights. You have no rights to talk to the school after 18. You have no rights to talk to your doctor. You have no rights to talk to anybody about your child's abilities. Will the doctor talk to you? Yeah, there are some health surrogate rules, but legally, you don't have authority. So you have four choices. first choice is do nothing. That's not a choice. Parents don't realize when your child turns 18, you don't have those rights anymore. So there are three levels, and it depends what state you live in, what's available to you. So the first level, it's the least restrictive, is supported decision-making. Supported decision-making is when your child's pretty high functioning and they can sign papers to other people. They keep their own rights, but they give some rights to, you'll be helping me with this, you'll be helping with helpers, they're assigning helpers. Most of us, for my children, I couldn't use that. The next one is your child actually has enough understanding to sign a power of attorney. Now, disabilities come in all flavors, all capacities, everything, right? So my child might have the understanding to say, I'm giving this person rights to make my medical decisions, and I'm giving someone the right to make my health care decisions. But most of us are going to court to become guardians, a lot, high percentage of us, because our child doesn't have the understanding to know what they're doing when they're giving those rights away. So A, very high level, giving some work away, saying, okay, I'm going to assign my brother to be my person who helps me with my budget. And I'm going to assign my sister to help me with getting a job. They can have these documents, or they can just sign powers. But the problem with signing powers, and every child needs to sign something, that if the hospital you sign is going, your child's going to, doesn't believe that your child has the capacity to sign that, they don't have to take it. So what's the other option? If your child can't make those decisions himself, then you're going to court either to become the guardian or conservator, depending upon where you live. They call it something different. But you're going to court, and you're asking the judge for permission to become your child's guardian. Judge is in control. The judge is going to say, if I believe that your child needs a guardian or I don't believe you. How do they decide? You're going to get medical records, okay? When your child turns by 18, by the time your child's into 18, you want to have a court date. If you're going to become guardian, you can work with an attorney. You can do it yourself. It depends upon county you live on, how difficult it is. But when you get that, you then become responsible for your child's decision. It is a court proceeding once a year. In your county you live in, will determine you have to go to court or you just have to send in a report. But you do have to report to the court as to where is this child living, how are they doing. Most people pick the form they did the year before and copy it. But if your child moves from another to one county to another or one state to another, they do have to move their guardianship to the new state. Okay, so it's to protect your child. If your child has a guardian and they do something like get a credit card somehow and sign it, it's not a real debt if they have a guardian. But if they don't have a guardian, it is a debt. Okay, so you're basically, when you become your child's guardian, you're taking their legal rights away. So it's in some cases for my sister, it was a really easy decision. She couldn't do it. For my sons, they probably could do some of it. So you have to weigh this really importantly. This other transition from child to adult is when we're doing our legal documents, the attorney is asking us, well, how do you want to split your money? There's no right answer here, right? Give $1 billion. Pretty easy answer. Split it three ways. There's three children. If you have limited money and you did that plan for your child and you said, well, this child needs 200,000 or 2 million or whatever it is, but you have 300,000. How do you split that 300,000 between the children equally if it's not going to give your child enough? So it's the head versus the heart. This is a really important decision you're making for the future of your child or children. Now, when you're younger, and your children are all young, you have to think about it differently because you want to get the other children up on their feet and you want to get them through college. But if your children are older, it's a different kind of thought process. So your head is telling you one needs more than the others. Our heart tells us we're supposed to treat our children equally. I will say, if you ask the other children, they probably don't feel like you think they feel. They probably are okay with it being unequal, but it's an important conversation to have, especially of adult children and why you're doing not even. Now, you can do all of this stuff perfectly. And then the law changes. They change them all the time. So either you stay up or you make sure that your people you work with stay up. I will tell you, the Secure Act is the act that they passed in 2020 and 2023. In 2020, it started by saying, if you retire, you don't have to take your money at 70 and a half anymore and force you to pay tax in your IRAs. But when they extended it to say, okay, you can wait till you're 70 and a half to from 70 and a half to 72, the law changed and said, yeah, but if we're going to let you wait till you pay your tax, your children have to pay the tax faster. When they passed that law, they gave preferential treatments to the taxation of retirement money to a special needs trust. So maybe all this time your estate plan looked a certain way because we didn't like to leave retirement money to the special needs trust. We left life insurance to the special needs trust. Now, because of the new tax law, we want to leave the retirement money to the special needs trust because the special needs trust gets to stretch the tax. Our other children have to pay the tax in 10 years. So I'm not expecting you to remember all this, but if you have a financial person you work with, they may not know this. Or your attorney, if you're a typical attorney, they don't know this. They may not know this, but most special needs attorneys know it. But I'll tell you, financial advisors know. Not very many of them. They know that IRAs, if you leave it to your children, it has to be paid off in 10 years if your children inherit it. Your children who have a special needs trust get special treatment. Even we had to work hard. The IRS just finally defined what that means, the 10-year rule. Nobody knew it when they said that. They didn't think it through. They just announced it last week. So we have to keep up with it, and we have to keep people informed just how it works. But also means when we're working with you, when we sit down and you're working with your whoever's helping you with your estate plan and your financial stuff, you're saying, how do I divide my money? Maybe you're going to change it now because the law's changed. So let's just recap the tools you need. You need special needs trusts. You need probably an ABLE account. I'm not going to get into it. The ABLE account is an account that you can put money away for your child, tax-free savings. I wish I was there so I could see the hands go up if you have one. It's a special funding mechanism. You get it through your state. Not every state has it, but most do. It's a way that you can put money away for your child, tax-free. Okay, it grows tax-free. You can put up to $18,000 a year. It's the amount of the gifting limit every year into your child's ABLE. They can only have one account, and there's rules. So the money in the ABLE is tax-free. It's like a college 529, but it's a special needs 529. It's actually called the 529A. You can put money in, it grows tax-free. When it comes out, just like a college 529, you have to use it for college. Here you have to use it for approved disability expenses, but the definition of that is very broad. Your child must have been disabled before the age of 26. Prior to 26, that affects in 2026. So in 2026, right now it's age 26. All of your children will be eligible for it. They're already disabled before the age of 26, I'm guessing. But they have to have been diagnosed or had the disability onset before the age of 26. Until 2026, it goes to 46. They can only have one account. Grandma can't open one up and you can't open one up. You can only put so much in a year, but that money in the ABLE does not count against them, right? So it's another way to save. But there's a couple of things that have to do with it. There's a lot of legislation on the table. You can move 529s into ABLE. There's other things. If your child works, they can put money into it. These things are in the law, but in 2026, they go away unless they're made permanent. There's other things in the law that we're hoping will be changed. Right now, in the ABLE account, if your child passes away and there's money in the ABLE account, the government can come back and claw back the money that hasn't been spent. So people aren't using it to put a lot of money in them. They're using it for short-term things. If you use an ABLE, check your ABLE. And if it's in the one in your state, like I live in Illinois, if you use the Illinois ABLE, if I put money in, I get a tax deduction up to a certain level. So if I want to put money in for my son and he needs it, I can put the money he needs for his rent, let's say, into the ABLE and he could take it out and use it, or I could pay his rent for him. I get a tax deduction in Illinois for putting it in. If you live in Wisconsin, you wouldn't get the tax deduction in Illinois. So you want to go and check out the accounts and see what's available. The other thing we're starting to do is we're hoping the legislation will allow employers to contribute to an ABLE just like a 401k. Company just called me, actually emailed me today and asked if I could help them understand where this law exists and when it might pass. Who knows, but it's on the table. Because if individuals with disability work, they can't put money in the 401k accounts against them. Okay. Now, this session was really about transition. So we've talked about how do you prepare your child? Make sure they're going to get their benefits. Make sure you have financially planned to help them get through that. And your plan takes into account their transition. Get your special needs trust set up. Find them a place to live, work, and play. All those things, right? All those pieces are important. How do you do that? How do you do all this? So understanding where your child is, if you do everything right, you do the special needs trust, you do the government benefits, you do your plan, you have a plan for your child, and then you pass away. Who knows it? How are you going to build this team? So your team consists of you in the middle, that PWD is your child. Everybody else, guardians and trustees, are family members. The coach is who you identify. You're really the key, right? So in my case, for my sons, I know my sister would step up and be the coach. Might not be a legal job. I call it the coach, right? Then I have to identify, if I'm going to create a company, I'm going to create all these people. If I go to all the extent when I create a company and I have a chief financial officer and I have a chief HR person and I've got a chief whatever, right? I'm going to do that for my child. If I'm going to get a job where somebody's going to take care of my child, don't be stingy with the jobs, right? If I'm going to say somebody's to be the guardian, somebody to be the trustee, if you want to really give family that job, then you better give them all their staff. And their staff's going to consist of who are the medical people? Who are the social people? Who's in a program that's running a program that's important to your child? Who's the faith support if you belong to a church or a synagogue? If your child's in a home, who's taking care of it? If you have financial professionals, a CPA who's going to do their taxes, and a trust company or insurance people or financial people, who are those people? Who is the attorneys that you work with? People pass away. They don't leave this information behind. I mean, I work with families and somebody passes away. We're the ones who step in and go and look for all those people who are like, wow, this family didn't do this yet, right? They didn't do their legal documents, or they didn't tell anybody where everything is at. So if you do a plan, it's only as good as this step, right? So how do you think about this? You think about it one thing at a time of all the things that you built, and keep a book and keep writing it down, right? We're going to build a soft. We've got some software that loads this, but we want to do the next level. You'll hear Protected Tomorrows has really just merged with a major company in this country. It's a company that is a provider of services to the financial industry. We are one of their partners now. We're going to help more and more people do what we do so that you can help get this kind of help. And some of this help is about what are the residential programs in this country? How do you find one? And if you do and you're looking and your child's not there yet, you got to have a book with all that information on it, because there's no guarantee how long we're going to live. We would live to be really long, and we could live to be really short. If your child's young and they're in school, these other people you put in charge, do they know that an IEP is not a parent-teacher meeting? It isn't, right? There's all these people in the room. A parent-teacher meeting is a parent and one person. It's not like that. If your child has any capacity to do something productive, what is it? Who are the doctors your child's seeing? If something happens to your child, who knows this? This is really important stuff. You can get professionals to do all the rest. This is on you, right? Who are the doctors to never see again? I know when I ask people, have you ever seen a doctor you've never seen? They're like, oh, their brain scans go up. We all have gone through that life's journey. Well, guess what? Your people you're picking have not, right? What's social life mean to your child? Everybody in the room has means something different. Routines. We forget routines, but we work really hard at building them. It's one of the key things we do as parents. We keep our child safe from the time they're born and diagnosed until the time we leave this earth. We are keeping our kids safe. Well, it's all the stuff that keeps them comfortable. My sister's thing was she couldn't see very well. She had her glasses on. She hated even when taking them off and went to sleep because it meant she couldn't see very good. And she knew exactly where to reach over and grab them when she woke up and somebody moved them from there. Her day was disrupted. She would call me and say, "Mir, somebody moved my glasses." It bothered her, right? There's all these things that we do because we build same. I call it the same world. We build it so that our kids' lives aren't disrupted and they understand what to expect and they feel safe. So if you want safe and happy, this is a big part of it. I did a program for parents, and I know we're going to run out of time, so I'm going to give you a couple little things. I had these parents there, and I had a couple of siblings who were now the guardians. Their parents had passed away. And I wanted the parents to hear what was important. And there's a woman there, and she got up and she says, "I want to share a story because I want the parents to know how important this is." So she got up and she said, "You know, my parents told me a lot, but I'm really mad at my mom. And I know she's gone, but I'm mad at her." So why? She, because my brother wears a certain kind of pants. It's the only pants he knows how to get up and on, and they all have to be the same, but they're shorter. He's short and stocky and he needs Velcro and they have to be short. And she said, "I can't find them. I've looked at every store. Nobody has these Velcro pants. They're short. They're fit a certain way," but she had a supply of them, but now he needs new ones. "I can't. I'm really mad at my mother that she couldn't even tell me this one little thing that was so important because my brother hates anything else I buy." So it's a little, this is this routine thing. It's a little stuff. My son he shot himself. So he had a very serious mental illness. And at one point he shot himself. He's alive, but he's blind. And he's seriously OCD. So nothing is clean. And when he first came home to live with me, I had to teach him to live like a blind person, but he also had to learn, I had to learn about his OCD-ness and the level at which it was at. And so I would go to work and I'd come home and I'd go to work and he'd be in the shower and I'd come home, he'd be in the shower in the middle of the night, he'd be in the shower. I didn't know that my water bill would go from $7,500 a quarter to over $3,000 in a quarter. And it was because he had the water on all the time. So I found a little thing to help us in our world. And the little thing cost $11 and I put it on the shower so that the water goes off after 10 minutes. It solved the problem. If something happens to me and my son moves in with you because you're the future guardian, is that a little thing you want to know about? A little $11 device that saves you some of the stress I put on our world, and I got rid of it with a little device. So he had to learn that the water got turned off, right? But it's those little things. It's not sometimes the big things we think about those. It's the little things you need to make sure that you're is in that team direction book for your families. Write it down. Do not forget this stuff, because there's no way that I know of that we communicate to the next generation. We're not on the planet anymore. There's just not. Your team consists of all of those people. So we have a worksheet, okay? We have a computer system where you can load this stuff, but we also have a paper copy of a worksheet. We're working on an enhanced system so that you could carry it on an app and you can load this. You start by building and saying, "Today I heard, you heard me talking about something and you're thinking, I know what it is, I gotta write that down." We'll have these worksheets available to you. What's the category? Is it medical? Is it fun days? What is it? We give it a position title. It's a team member. And who are those people? So if I said, "I really want the medical team and I need his primary care and I need his eye doctor and I need these other things," who are those people? Because he doesn't know them, can't remember them. And then who are they? So not only do I need his doctors, but who are the doctors? What's their phone number? Okay. In your cases, it might be who's the teachers. It might be, do the people all you in your lives know about this conference that you go to once a year that they might need to go to, right? So create this, but it's not any good either if you don't tell people where it is. If it's on the computer, if it's in a book you made, have a family meeting. I say pick a time, do it 6 months after your child's birthday every year. Bring those families into your life and say, "We're going to teach you about what we do." If you don't think they want to know, they do. I hear families all the time when the siblings come in and say, "I wish mom and dad would talk to me." Or I had a bunch of siblings on a webinar once, and I had siblings really involved, and I had siblings who knew nothing, and I let them share their stories. And some of them had been a guardian for years. Some were just became a guardian. Some were just learning they were going to be a guardian, and one, their parents, their mother, parents, never talked to them. Don't be that. Talk, all right? So, wow, I think we now covered a lot. I think our time is just about up. Let's see if there's any specific questions somebody wanted to put in the chat. I don't have access to the chat room right now. So, but if you have questions, there is an email address. It's info, I get these, info@protectedtomorrows.com. I'm going to suggest that you can go ahead and put, you know, the questions on those. I will respond to you directly, or one of my team members will. And if there are very specific things you want some help with, just let us know. So you can either email at this email address, or you can go to protectedtomorrows.com and you can go on the contact us screen. That's the fastest way I get it, even faster than the email. And my staff knows when they get it, they know who to distribute it to immediately because they're all broken down by category. And I want to thank you for being generous with your time today and allowing me to be here in this format so that I could be here for my family this weekend that I had to be here. Any questions that are urgent that are in the chat box, I'll ask the AD to check that.
Do you want to leave that slide up for a minute so everyone can take down an email address?
Sure. Absolutely. So it's info@protectedtomorrows.com, or you can go right to the email, the site, and there's a contact us screen. Click on the top. We know it works because we get lots of questions and lots of, you can also sign up for our newsletter. And in the newsletter, you will get information. So we have a free class every month. The next class is about transportation system for the disabled. Every month, the one after that is going to be a very detailed class about that retiring for three process that we went through. We're going to have another class with some people talking about stress and how do we deal with stress as caregivers. But every month we have varied classes and they're free. All you have to do is sign up and participate. You can't, they're on Thursdays, one Thursday a month. And if you can't participate, if you sign up, you'll get a recording of the program and you just go to the site and put in the code we sent you. So everything is complimentary. And thank you so much for letting us be here with you this afternoon.
Yeah, thank you. Everyone have the address? Thank you so much, Marianne.
Thank you. Have a great weekend, everyone.